About this time, you'll notice there are statements about the terrible thing that's about to happen. And many scholars say, during a time of turmoil, like this rebellion began in 64, you see. And it wasn't until 70 that the Romans crushed that area. So that's one of the reasons, not the only one of the reasons people say around 70. And by 70, I'd say 65 to 70, something like that. And do you know, according to Eusebius of Caesarea, where Mark got his information? Because he was not one of the 12. According to the first work writing about the, shall we say, the history of the Chronicle of Christianity, was written in the 4th century, and notice, 300 years plus. So that's the reason we have to say, according to tradition, Mark got his information from Peter. Now, is that fact? No. Nobody knows. We do know that the other three gospel writers used sources. Luke tells us he's going to use sources. So the chances are all of the gospel writers use sources, plural rather than singular. But Mark, you'll notice Mark is the shortest. Mark's gospel, you have Jesus the most. He is a man of action. He's always on the move. Each of the gospel writers gives us a different sequence, different account. But, okay, if I could ask every single one of you what we did this morning, what we talked about, do you think we'd get a unanimous statement about what we talked about? Okay, then we shouldn't expect Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to be the same. In fact, the value is they're different. That's what makes the four so valuable. They're different. Any questions?
No, but I think it's interesting that none of them were written when none of these people knew Jesus when he was alive.
That is quite possible. According to tradition, Matthew, the tax collector, wrote Matthew. We don't know that. That's simply, the book doesn't say so.
Similarly named.
That's right. Same thing, the closest we can come, people are fairly sure that Luke Acts was written by Luke the physician, because of some of the language in it and some of the references. But again, he says he was using sources. He was not one of the 12. And so, this is, we want to focus on the text, not this other stuff, really. Because what is all of this material? What is called the Word of God, isn't it?
Yeah.
Remember word like message, the message of God? And I love something, I don't know whether it's original with him, but I've heard him say it many times. Deacon Alan Christie says, the Bible is God's love letter to his people. I like that. All right, Julie, read the first sentence.
The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Notice, that's in effect a title. the beginning of, what does the word gospel mean?
Good news.
Good news. The good news of Jesus, and what does Christ mean?
Messiah.
Christ is Greek, Messiah is Hebrew. What's the English?
Anointed one.
The anointed one. Okay, and kings, priests, and in late Judaism, prophets were anointed. What's the focus in the Gospels? Which one? Jesus as king, Jesus as prophet, or Jesus as
anointed,
as priest?
Which ones? All three.
All three are not equally emphasized in the Gospels.
Prophet?
You certainly get some sense of prophet, but okay, Jesus is called the Son of God, yes, but he's also called the Son of
Man.
Man.
Son of Man, correct. Son of Man, and but Son of Man means simply human, really. Except that it probably refers to the passage in Daniel. And who is the Son of Man in Daniel? Daniel 7 we looked at. Who does the text itself say the Son of Man is? Remember, the Son of Man came before the Ancient of Days. The court, the books were open, the court was convened, and the Son of Man appears.
People?
The people, the holy people of God.
Whenever he was called Son of Man, that really got everybody upset. I mean, that was like,
you're right. Everybody upset because it's saying he's the sum total of us. What do you mean the sum total of us? How can he be?
That's the stubborn Jewish people, are mostly.
I'd say stubborn anybody.
That doesn't upset me. No, but it shouldn't upset anybody nowadays.
Well, anybody who says, I sum up all of you people. Think that wouldn't upset anybody?
No.
I think it might. Okay, Son of God, Son of Man, who else? Son of
David.
So then what's the focus of the Christ?
King.
Okay, good. All right, the beginning of the good news of Jesus the king, the anointed king. Yes,
I just thought that was a coincidence. I hate to use that word. But when he was crucified, the Roman emperor said, put king of the Jews there, and then they got all bent out of shape. And he said,
right.
What is what I have said? Sticks, you know.
All right.
That's
why
the same
would they
thing
get bent out of shape?
Because they said, it's down in history as king. I mean,
why would they be bent out of shape over Jesus having the label King of the Jews?
They didn't accept him as that.
That's right.
Yeah. But isn't it funny that that happened? I mean,
not really.
Well, that's a coincidence.
It's not. It's, well, think of what.
It's like.
Think of the name of
the
one. Think of the name, Dave, of the one who was released in place of Jesus. What was his name?
Barabbas.
Do you know what that word means?
Lucky guy.
Do you know what that Barabbas? Do you know what Barabbas means?
Son of a robber or something like that?
Son of Abba?
Oh, son of the father.
Son of the father. Abba. Bar. Simon Bar Jonah. Simon, son of Jonah. Bar Mitzvah? Do you see? Bar is son of. So, The Gospels are full, the Bible, not just the Gospels, are full of irony. We think we're so sharp, and we often...
That's a better word than consequences.
We think we're so sharp, and very often we're making the same mistakes our parents did. Do we not learn anything? Sometimes it seems like we don't. Okay. Notice, the beginning of the good news of Jesus, the King, the Christ, the Son of God. Now, does Son of God say he's divine?
Sort of.
Well, let's, do you remember Exodus chapter 4? Let's go back there. You see why I said, okay, even though we've been through all this material, I'm going to keep taking you back there?
Because we don't remember.
Well, I think for good reason, there's a lot of material we've covered. Exodus chapter 4. Sheila, we're glad you can come and...
I hope I find where I'm supposed to go.
Yes, out the door and then right across.
Okay, thank you.
But thanks for coming, and as I told you before, come late, leave early, it's fine with me.
No attendance.
Pardon?
No attendance taken.
No attendance taken, that's right.
But there will be tests.
There will be tests, but it's up to God to give it.
Oh, okay. That's one for you, John.
All right. Let's see. Jerry, you got it?
I got chapter 4. Where do you want me?
Chapter 4, I'd like you to start with verse 21.
The Lord said to him, on your return to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders I have put in your power. I will make him obstinate, however, so that he will not let the people go. So you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. Hence I tell you, let my son go that he may serve me. If you refuse to let him go, I warn you, I will kill your son, your firstborn.
Okay. Does Son of God automatically say divine? Who is Israel here?
The nation.
The nation, the people. That's right. Then does Son of God automatically say divine? Is the book of Exodus saying that the people of Israel are God?
Well, they're saying that they're the sons of God.
Son of God, though, right? Well, who was the father of Adam?
God.
Okay. We have a hard time with this because we have been taught so often, appropriately, that we need to be careful about arrogance.
And is the deciding word begotten then? Is that, does that,
no,
make a distinction?
No, that doesn't make a bit of difference. Okay. Doesn't make a bit of difference.
The only begotten son.
Yeah.
Is that like the... The one that separates us from the children of Earth.
In that sense,
it puts on a higher level, like
it's saying Jesus is uniquely a son of God, only begotten.
But then again,
we're sons and daughters of God. St. Paul says by adoption. But notice, he made us.
That's not an adoption. He misspoke.
I'm sorry?
I think Augustine misspoke. He's trying to...
No, he didn't misspeak.
No?
The church still teaches that.
But that's like taking away what we just read.
No.
We're all in the same family, so.
That's right.
That's like putting cream on it or something. I don't know.
What St. Augustine taught about divinization, the doctrine of divinization, the theology, look at the Catholic Catechism and you'll find it. So what St. Augustine said is still the teaching of the churches in the current Catholic Catechism. So that's not, that still is.
Nowhere does it say anything about being adopted children.
It does in St. Paul.
St. Paul says we're adopted children.
St. Paul says, and notice, what is the statement? God made us, but what did we do?
We sinned.
We sinned. And what does that mean?
Separated ourselves from
God. We separated ourselves from God. Then he made us, and like the father, the prodigal son, he restored us. And even raised us above where we were. But in a very real sense, remember, do you remember what the Catholic Catechism calls the state of Adam and Eve? What was their relationship in?
It was pretty good. I mean, it was perfect.
Okay. Do you remember exactly what it says? They were in the state of original holiness and justice. They were in the state of original holiness and justice. By the way, in Hebrew and in Greek, you can't say justice without saying righteousness. You can't say righteousness without saying justice. It's that same kind of thing.
So when Christ came, he sort of like reopened the door for us to, and he's the king. He's the belief in him is our way of getting out of the sinful.
But what does believe in him mean? Remember St. Paul says, you believe, you do well. The devils also believe and shudder.
Well, what's the difference? Or obeying? Or...
So are we simply asked to believe that there is a God?
There's got to be more, right? Yeah.
Got to be more than that.
Yeah.
Are we asked just to believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Is that good enough?
No.
Notice, the whole teaching of the scripture is, what did Jesus say? You will do what I do. You will obey my commandments. All of these things. In short, simply believing that something is, believing that God exists, believing even that Jesus is the Son of God, if it has nothing to do with us except mere intellectual assent, how can we then be sons and daughters of God? We're still in the far country, tending to the hogs. Okay?
Really? I have a question.
Yep.
I thought of it when it said that it was going to slay the firstborn son. What is a good response? I have a person who's always saying to me that God is all good and kind and loving. How could he go around telling people to kill people?
How can he go around?
Killing all those people. Letting all those people be killed.
Okay. Good question. Good question. The Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, gives us a response to that Whether we can carry it forward is a different matter. But first of all, let's go back to the Abrahamic covenant. I will bless you and make your name great. Right? I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you so that means, what does the word so that mean?
In order
for that to happen, right? So that through you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Okay? Who then is responsible for, if you will, teaching all the earth according to God as he speaks to Abraham?
We are.
Pardon?
We're supposed to.
No, as he speaks to Abraham, in the immediate context there, who's supposed to? Through whom are all the nations supposed to bless
Abraham?
Abraham. So Abraham is supposed to teach all the nations, right? In fact, the prophets say again and again and again. Listen for it at the Mass. During the readings for the prophets, they say again and again and again, all people will come to Jerusalem to be taught. Who's in Jerusalem?
Abraham's
descendants, right on. Do you follow? Now, of course, this is referring to the time when the Jews were there.
Well, that addresses what people are supposed to be taught about God, but how about allowing the death of those that...
That's where I'm going.
Okay.
I needed that first.
Gotcha.
Okay, you with me there? Okay. I will bless those who bless you. Right? In fact, we have all sorts of examples of that. Those who treated Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob well received a blessing. Right? We saw this. What about those who treated Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob badly in some sense? For instance, taking Sarah into his harem. Mm-hmm. He was, notice, none of his wives could conceive. And it's going to be even worse than that. So, notice, the destruction was to protect the people of Israel, through whom all the nations would be blessed. Now, first of all, notice, when were God's people formed? Actually, a number of rabbis have written on this, so I'm getting this not from Christian sources, but from Jewish sources. It was during the Exodus that God formed a people for himself. That's when God saved his people, when he redeemed them, when he ransomed them, when he became their savior. Now they were chosen from the beginning, right? From the time of Abraham's response, Abraham's descendants were chosen. Okay, but that's a long formation period. In fact, what did the prophets say? Again and again and again. The remnant, the faithful remnant, will be the one that is saved. Not all of them. Am I responding, reader? I'm not through. Am I beginning to respond? In other words, those who attacked or would attack or would destroy the Jewish people, they themselves were destroyed. Okay, that's the first part.
Right.
Second part is this. According to Genesis 6, what were the people like when Noah and his family were, to use the language of the letter of James, said when Noah and his family were saved by the water, what was the state of the rest of the people?
Evil in every way.
Evil in every way. Every inclination of their hearts was only evil continually. Now, what were they called? The
Nephilim.
Nephilim. Okay, when Joshua, remember Moses led the people out of Egypt, right? Who else could you say led the people out of Egypt besides Moses?
Aaron.
No, not Aaron.
God.
Joshua?
God.
Oh, God.
Oh. Moses and God led the people out of Egypt, right? Moses didn't make it to the promised land, remember?
Right.
Who picked up where Moses left off?
Was that Joshua?
Joshua. Okay, when Joshua and the other spies went into the land to spy it out, what did they find there?
Giants.
Yeah.
And what were they called? The Nephilim. Notice, they were seen as irremediably evil. And so this is the explanation that the Bible itself provides. Now there's one more. What about why were the people of God taken into captivity, into Babylon?
They disobeyed God.
They disobeyed God. They went their own way. And notice what you find again and again. You sell the people for a pair of shoes. In other words, how you treat other people tells what your relationship to God is. That's Old Testament and New Testament. Questions? Am I responding?
I still don't want to say. If God is all loving.
Okay. He's all loving, so those who would do harm to those who follow him
just deserve.
Okay, I'll put it like this. Reader, don't you want good for all people in the world? I know you well enough to ask you that, so okay.
Well, maybe one or two. Just kidding.
But, okay. If somebody is going to blow up this room and kill us all, would you say, don't hurt him, don't hurt him, let him go? You wouldn't say that. Agreed?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Those who would do harm to those who are following God. Now, of course, one of the problems with that is that so many of us are going 16,000 different directions, and all of us say, we're people of God. To claim it is one thing, to be it is another. Remember, what did the Pharisees say to Jesus? We are the sons of Abraham. And Jesus said, I can raise up sons from these very stones. Saying it is one thing, being it is another. In other words, if you're a son of Abraham, you don't act like that. That's an effect.
Okay, thank you.
If we are Christians, we don't act like whatever.
That's like saying your action speaks so loud I can't hear what you say.
It's true. It's true. And, you know, this is what we're dealing with is life. And without this guidance, I'm reminded of what a good friend of mine said. He is himself not a Christian, not baptized. Knows more about Catholic teachings than anybody I know, really. And I just grieve over him, to tell you the truth. But somebody said to him one day, I can't see that your degree has made you the kind of person you ought to be. You know, it's a PhD, okay? And here's what he said. You're right. I'm not what I ought to be. But I'm so much better because of what I studied than I would be if I hadn't.
So he's a work in progress.
And I think of that so often about myself and about the church and so on. No, we aren't what we ought to be. But we're so much better than we would be without it. Do you follow me? Okay. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So even though he says Son of God, that doesn't automatically mean Jesus is divine. Now, yeah.
I'm glad you came back to that, because the example you used where you said that the people of Israel were the Son of God, which is a collective group.
That's right.
Jesus was an individual. Why doesn't that make him divine?
Okay, good. Thank you for having me pick this up. Go to Psalm 2. Psalm 2. The book of Psalms is pretty close to the center of the Bible. Psalm 2. Mary, you got it? let's see, start from the top.
Why do the nations protest and the peoples grumble in vain? Kings on earth rise up. And princes plot together against the Lord and his anointed.
Against the Lord and his anointed. His anointed would be?
His priest.
Pardon?
His priest.
In this case,
people of Israel?
Actually, this is a coronation song. So the Lord and his anointed, that's the Lord. Do you know what I mean by coronation song? Crowning of the king. Okay. Start again. With second verse.
Let us break their shackles and cast off their chains.
Okay, this is this is what the people are saying, right? Let us burst their shackles and cast off their whose shackles?
The people are breaking the binds of the earthly kings.
That's right. Those people who are opposing God and the king. Okay, keep reading.
The one enthroned in heaven laughs. The Lord derides them, then speaks to them in anger, terrifies them in wrath. I myself have installed my king on Zion.
Notice, I myself have installed my king on my holy mountain. King of Israel, right? Okay, keep reading.
I will proclaim the decree of the Lord who said to me, you are my son today, I am your father.
Notice, okay, who is the Son of God here? Today you are my son, isn't that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
You are my son, today I've begotten you. Who is that?
The king.
The king. So, notice, one of the things we saw, starting with the people of God, this kept being moved in and becoming centralized. All the firstborn were to be devoted to God, right? Consecrated to God. Okay, then who is it who's going to represent the firstborn?
The descendants.
No? Who's going to represent the firstborn as they're going through the wilderness, the desert? Remember, there's a rebellion. What group killed those who rebelled? You remember this? The Levites. Who were the Levites?
Priests.
That's the priestly tribe. Then God says the Levites will represent God's firstborn. There will be a Levite for every firstborn. Okay? Notice, what is that saying God's people are to be? Priests. In fact, it's stated explicitly in Exodus 19:6. You shall be for me a nation of priests, a holy people.
So how do you accomplish this? I mean, what do you have to do to fulfill your priestly duties as?
You're an intermediary between God and the rest of the people.
By your example? What?
By word and example, exactly. Yeah. All right. Then notice the king, by the way, David performs priestly functions, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. Yeah, he performs priestly functions. So notice, he's a king and a priest. And Jesus calls him what else? A prophet. Okay, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Where does that come from?
Jesus.
Comes from Jesus, but it didn't originate with Jesus unless you go back before the Old Testament. Where did that come from?
Psalm 22.
Pardon?
Psalm 22.
Oh, yeah.
Psalm 22.
That's David's psalm.
That's David's psalm. Okay? So notice, prophet, priest, and king, David. So no surprise, the book of Hebrews says Jesus is prophet, priest, and king. Okay, now, when you were baptized and anointed, you were anointed what?
Prophet, priest, and king.
Exactly. So notice, that keeps coming, it keeps being centralized, and then what did Jesus do? Turned it the other direction. Do you see? It comes together in Jesus, prophet, priest, and king. And then all who are called by my name, prophet, priest, and king. Do you realize how awesome the Bible says our faith is? We're sons and daughters of God. We're his prophets, his priests. And as St. Paul says, we will reign with him. Kings. We have a hard time with that, I think. We can't believe who we are. So we aren't that so often.
If you preached that loud enough, people would kind of think you were crazy, or I mean, it's almost scary. And I could see where people would resent that, and they would maybe try to crucify you.
Interesting statement, Dave. Yeah. By the way, I don't know whether you know it, but Father Jim catches what for? A lot.
By saying that?
By preaching.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
By preaching the word of God.
And what do people expect?
Yeah,
really. I guess that kind of thing.
Well, what are they upset about? What has he said?
Oh, he's always talking about social things.
Well, somebody had said to me the other day, and it just made me so upset. Why does he, he's at a funeral. Why does he think he has to give a homily at every funeral?
What?
It's all about him. And I think to myself, do you know what you just said? And I was just, and there's no reaching her because it was like, I couldn't believe someone had said that about him. He's consoling the family. These are the readings the family picked up, and he puts it all together. Just, well, anyway, I was.
Is the devil at work with people like that?
Well, I really need to answer that.
I guess I got my answer then.
Is she a widow?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, then she ought to know, because I'm a recent widow, and I really enjoy the homily. I got a lot out of that.
When they pick the readings, the family picks the readings, and it just ties it all together. Yes. They're living their life, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I just, when she said that, I think to myself, it's all about him. I said, it's not about him. And if you're trying to sit there and defend your priest, it's like, oh my goodness.
Well,
I enjoy hearing it just as much as the family. Yeah.
We've got a long way to go. We're a work in progress. We got a long way to go through this wilderness.
You better start preaching, John.
If God formed his people as they were coming through the desert, the wilderness, land, he's still at it, I'm afraid. Thanks be to God, he's still at it.
Well, we're supposed to see Jesus in every person we meet every day. And some days it's hard, but you just got to keep trying.
You know, one of the things that I think is, sometimes I think we look at the wrong people. God said, we're supposed to be looking at the most needy. And we're often looking at those who have the most.
Yeah, that's true. I would say that.
Do you follow me?
I know, but I'm not sure.
I'm not saying that we're not to see Jesus in everybody. We are.
Yeah.
But I think it makes it harder when we're looking at the people who are, let's say, not exactly living the way they ought to be.
Yeah. But that helps me to remember that, because when I see somebody doing something that's very un-Christ-like, I just keep thinking, he's got some work to do, too.
Now, how do you help the needy when we don't want help?
Yeah.
You cannot do something for somebody who doesn't want it. Interesting. We have a lady in the Spanish Mass who, I mean, has struggled. She was a widow with four children, for instance, 12 children by herself. She has struggled for years. And you know what she says? I don't need help. God is all the help I need. So sometimes we think, and okay, I'll be honest with you. I was going to give her some help recently, because here she is again in a desperate plight. She lost her home. And I went to her and I said, would you let us help you? Is there anything we can do? Her response, the Lord has taken care of me all my life. He still will take care of me.
But he works through us to help other people.
That's right, but those people have to feel like they need it. We can't impose it. That's correct. We are to help the needy. But I suppose we have to say it's the people who are needy who have to tell us We can't say you're needy, so I'm going to give you this.
But that's a real humbling thing to go to someone and say, are you needy? Oh.
It absolutely is. That's the reason I tried to make it so that I would not embarrass her. I went to her private and I said, how are you doing? I know this is a rough time. Is there any way we can help you? And her response. And so, you know.
But would she receive help if you just did it on her own, graciously? No?
No. She, in fact, somebody gave her $1,000. And you know what she did with it? She used it to help some other people.
But that's what her choice was.
That is her choice.
Yeah.
And so, but I thought it was interesting that somebody anonymously.
And that may have given her a lot of joy to be able to share it.
Absolutely. And so, you know, what?
But she loses her home.
She had lost her home. She did.
So who does she live with then? It's like
her daughter.
Or her daughter. But that, do you see that as a burden sometimes?
Well, no. Her daughter's husband has just left her. This lady has gone through, I cannot believe. And yet, boy, she is all, I've never seen her when she wasn't on. She's amazing.
Well, that's a true picture of faith.
That's a true picture of faith. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, as we think on your word, as we think about all that you've given to us, all that you've taught us, help us, our Father, to recognize the huge gifts you have given to us in your teaching and in your earthly blessings. We pray, Father, that we may grow in faith, in hope and in love, as we seek to live out the great calling you've given to us, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
John, she was talking about finding the Christ in people. When she asked the question about finding the Christ in people, perhaps some of the times that we heard your slogan.
There's so much good in the worst of us, and so much bad in the best of us, it hardly leaves any of us to criticize the rest of us.
That's right. That's true.